Hi, Jewish mom. So I'm back at my real computer, my new computer. I'm happy to be I'm also at my new JewishMom.com international headquarters, my desk. I want to tell you about an interesting experience that I had about 11 years ago. I was at the very beginning of my pregnancy with my 10-year-old. And this is something probably I should write off one day. It was actually quite an interesting and unusual experience. About 11 years ago, my first book came out called Expecting Miracles, about pregnancy. I received a very unusual invitation from the Black Hebrews of Dimona. The Black Hebrews, if you've never heard of them, they're a group of American, African Americans, and they believe that they are the true chosen people, that they are the true Jews, the true Israelites of the Bible. That's them. They've set up a community. Most of them are centered in Dimona in the south of Israel. There's some living in other places, let's say Mitzpe Ramon, but most of them are in Dimona. I was invited. The Black Hebrews extended an official invitation to me, to come down because they wanted to show me something that they call the Beit HaKayim. Beit HaKayim is the Beit HaChaim. They can't pronounce the letter Chet, so they pronounce all Chets as K's. They give birth in like a little birthing compound on their own, with women from the community. So they wanted me to come down and see their Beit HaKayim. I just want to tell you some things about my visit there, and an interesting conversation that I had there, which is what I want to, which is sort of the main purpose of my sharing this story today. The Black Hebrews, first of all, I would have to say like that I was treated very, very nicely. I was welcomed very, very sweetly by the people there. The women were really nice and very welcoming to me. They told me about their way of life. They have a way of life which they believe is the most healthy way of life that there is. They believe that in fact, if you really, really keep their way of life, then you will achieve immortality. For example, they have a very strictly vegan lifestyle. They eat for they have like when I was there, they took me to a factory where they make tofu, and that's very important to them. They do, I believe it's called colon washes. I'm forgetting exactly what it is, but they do enemas and colon washes, whatever it's called. I don't remember exactly the name. They took me to like a center where they do that. We met a sports trainer. All of the people there. All the members of this community, they're required to exercise every week a certain amount. I remember that the sports trainer there, a very friendly man, and he said, and he was I probably at least in his 60s when we met him, possibly in his 70s, and he assured me. He said, I want to tell you, I promise you, if you come back here in 400 years, I will still be here. Like they really believe that by living this very healthy lifestyle that they are going to be immortal. The reason I want to tell you the reason the thing I want to tell you about the story which I'm with which is the point of why I'm telling all this for this pep talk, is that something very interesting was that the entire day I was accompanied by some young mothers. These young mothers, they were sort of assigned to be like my official guides to the community. They were really so sweet. They were really lovely people. There was one young mother there who showed me around. In this community, then it's a polygamous community. Then husbands can take more than one wife. This young mother. It was interesting because the time was 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock, and I said, you're a mother. And she told me this young woman, this mother I was with, she had a bunch of kids. So I said, you're here, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock, like who's watching your kids now? And she said, oh, my sister wife. the other wife was taking care of the ch children. So I'm not saying it wasn't a, in some ways it's a very problematic situation. Like so I asked her something else I wanted to mention. So I remember I asked her, I said, "Oh, you have a sister wife? How is that?" And she gave me this very sharp look and she said, I said, no, I said, "How did you feel when your husband married another wife?" And she gave me a very sharp look and said, "How do you think I felt about it?" Right? So it's not a very easy, it's not so easy, that polygamous kind of situation. But in terms of logistics, in terms of being a mother, it really, really makes things easier. This mother had a lot of freedom because basically the mother, like all of the husband's wives, that they work together and they raise the kids together. So another thing I want to tell you about, another story which I should write up also, at another point, is that many years ago, and I think in 1990, I was spending a semester abroad in Indonesia. And I spent a few months in Bali, in Indonesia. And as I was part of like this study abroad program, I think it was called the Experiment in International Living. And so all of us students, we were all American college students, and we were all assigned to and we're all assigned to live with a Balinese family. So I was living in, basically all of us were living in a compound with a family. What was very interesting there was like I had my own little room and I was living next to a couple with a son, maybe he was about three. And then this the husband's father live elderly father lived in the compound, as did an unmarried sister, as did another aunt. So you get the story. So basically there's only one young child there who's three. But he was being raised by an entire group of adults. This is sort of I assume that many traditional societies live in this kind of compound kind of situation. It made it much, much, much easier to raise him because it wasn't always, everything wasn't only on the mother and the father. There was also the grandfather and the aunt and the unmarried sister, and there was an entire, basically, as someone once said, it takes a village to raise a child. And in these two sort of more traditional ways of living, I think also the polygamous society, I'm saying, like, we look in the Torah, we see, Yaakov had many wives. Like this was in traditional societies, it was quite accepted in certain societies to have polygamy. And it was a much easier way to raise a child. You sort of automatically had a village raising your child. So I don't think I'm telling you anything that you don't know by saying that, that motherhood is hard, it's challenging, and all of us now, I assume all of us pretty much, we're living with, we're raising our children pretty much on our own. We with a certain amount of help from our husbands, and some of us may be like your parents are nearby, but still, even if your mother is right down the block, it still makes it easier, but it's still hard. It's still like so much on us, so much more than was the norm when like kids were really being raised in a village, I think it's so important that we find ways to make things easier. Right now, my mother-in-law's here, and seeing my life through my mother-in-law's eyes, it makes me see all the ways in which I cut corners. So I just want to give you some examples. I'm not giving these examples as like a as instruction to you, as though you should cut corners in the same way that I do. The reason I'm telling you the ways in which I cut corners is to give you permission. Give you permission. It's not easy. You're not raising you. None of us, I assume, are raising our children in a village kind of situation. We are raising our children basically on our own. We and our husbands are raising our children on our own. So I think, and I just want to give you permission to do what you need to do to make that happen, to do what you need to do to cut the corners of what's not so essential. I once heard from somebody, there's someone, a woman who lives in Jerusalem named Rivka Marga Gestetner. She's a Rebbetzin. And many years ago, she was talking with a group of young mothers, and she said, as a mother, you are juggling hundreds of balls, hundreds of balls. And she said, and your responsibility is to make sure that none of the important balls fall. right? So that means, for example, your health, your children's health, safety, your marriage, things like that. Okay? So I want to give you some examples of things of corners that I personally have cut. One is that I have a 3-year-old and it's very, very difficult. My Yakov, he's so adorable, but he's impossible to get dressed. He has very, very, very strong opinions about what he wants to wear. So what I've started doing is I get Yakov dressed when he's sleeping. Before I go to bed at night, I get Yakov dressed for the next day. Okay? Because otherwise, I know if I wait until 7 in the morning to get him dressed, it's going to take me 20 minutes and it's going to be a lot, very exasperating. And so that's like one way I cut corners. Another thing is that so my baby and my 3-year-old, I only give them baths on Fridays. I know, like, the ideal mother, I'm supposed to be doing baths every night. There's sort of like this idea, I'm doing baths before bedtime. But in my house, that doesn't exist. We don't have baths before bedtime. We have baths before Shabbat. Another thing is that when I cook every Sunday, and I cook pretty much for the whole week. I cook food from Monday through Wednesday. So we eat the same food Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and then on Thursday's spaghetti. You know, it's like we have certain very. I've come up with a schedule, like a food schedule, which makes it. It's really cutting corners, but it's something that it enables me. To focus on what I consider important, and to stay, which is, I guess, staying sane and staying as relaxed as I can in a situation where I have a lot of people depending on me, and I have a lot of very important balls to keep in the air. So in conclusion, I want to bless you, Jewish moms, that you should look at your own life and think about and to appreciate how difficult it is, to appreciate how you're doing something which not so many women in history have had to do. Most women in history, I think, probably lived in situations where, like, they had extended family around, or they had like a supportive village around them helping them. And we are raising our kids on our own, pretty much, you know, with a certain amount of help from our husbands, some more, some less. That's okay. But we need to remember, just to remember that of course it's important to keep the important balls up in the air. Remember to cut what you can cut so that you can focus on what's important. Namely, staying sane, staying relaxed, staying healthy, while you manage to still keep all those hundreds of balls up in the air. And I want to conclude with a wonderful quote that I read in Family First this week from Hani Machlis. From Mevatan Hani Machlis and Zichron Alevecha. So she, one of her daughters quoted her as saying that being a mother, being a Jewish mother, it's not easy, but it's definitely worthwhile. Okay, I want to bless all of you Jewish moms with an amazing, amazing week called Tish.